Good evening, everyone. I am Michael DiPaolo, a second-year medical student at RCSI Bahrain. Today, I want to talk to you about something often overlooked in sports, an athlete's transition to life after sports. I'm here to share with you my journey on how I managed to go from being a professional hockey player to a medical student, as well as the good, the bad, and the ugly that came along the way. Rising through the hockey ranks to eventually become a pro player is an incredible accomplishment that brings a great reward. However, the chances of going from minor hockey to a steady NHL career are roughly 1 in 4,000. There were over 500,000 kids in Canada registered in hockey last year. And it's understood that less than 1% of all hockey players go on to have NHL careers. So what happens to all the guys that don't make it? For many athletes, and for me, my entire identity was wrapped up in my sport. I dedicated 21 years and countless hours to training, competing, and honing my craft. My body was built to take the hits, built for the game, until it wasn't. My life as a pro hockey player ended shortly after it had started. Being 6'4" at the age of 15 seemed like it'd be an advantage. I was drafted in the fourth round to the Ontario Hockey League, and to be drafted in any sport is an accomplishment. My agent at the time called me 1 week before my first training camp and said, if I wanted to make the team as a 16-year-old, I needed to fight to make it. So I did, and I became good at it and made a career out of it. However, from then on, my identity was an enforcer, and I became only utilized to fight. But fighting got me to two NHL tryouts, one with the Columbus Blue Jackets in 2014 and the San Jose Sharks in 2015. By this time, I'd been in close to 50 fights. Who knows how many times I've been punched in the head at this point. You want to see what that looks like? Take a look.
Taking notice, and here we go.
Here we go now, as we've got Tucker White and DiPaolo. Some cross rights by DiPaolo. He's landing every one of them right now, trying to come back. And on the ropes is going to be Tucker White. He tried, boys, I tell you what, smokes him with a left. And luckily for Tucker White, oh my goodness, luckily the shield stays on. Yeah.
Fighting was also the beginning of the end for me. I received several concussions, cortisone injections in my knuckles just to be able to hold my stick, muscle relaxers, and no surgery. It was hard to prove to my coaches and my teammates that I could score and make plays when I couldn't even hold my stick, see out of both eyes, or breathe normally. The main point here is that no single person, agent, coach, alumni, family member, or friend ever sat me down and educated me on the consequences of fighting. In major junior hockey, the league often sends out organizations like the Red Cross to talk to teams about some critical topics. However, one of the most essential topics always being left out is fighting and the effects that occur long-term on retired hockey players. So while I won most fights, I lost a couple, but I quickly realized that there was no real winner in the long run. The other reason my career came to an end is the scholarship rule. Basically, what this means is that every year you play in the league, you receive 1 year scholarship to any school in Canada, but you only have access to the scholarship up to 18 months after your last game. Luckily for me, I had an 18-month window that I can try the professional route before cashing in on my education package. This rule forced me to sit and think, do I really want to fight my way to the NHL like this? Did I want to be this young and already targeted as one of the tough guys? In 2015, I met with a former coach, Alex Galchenyuk Sr. I had maybe 3 or 4 months left to decide if I wanted to continue playing hockey and use my scholarship or lose my scholarship or go to school. He sat me down and he said, Mike, I think you need to stop. You're playing in the East Coast Hockey League and you're fighting every other game. It's going to be hard to make it to the NHL like this. In hindsight, it was a crucial talk at one of the most critical times of my life. Also a very tough pill to swallow. I spent 17 years chasing the NHL dream at this point, and I was realizing that it was slipping away. I wasn't enjoying the process anymore, the limited playing minutes, or the pregame nap, knowing I would have to fight guys even bigger than me. A few weeks later, I didn't know, but that night, I would play my last professional hockey game and have my last fight ever. I was on the trainer's table again with a broken nose. That is when I decided I had to stop playing hockey and use my scholarship. This was in early December, so I didn't have much time. The second semester started in just 3 weeks. By New Year's Day in 2016, I was attending Western University. Not because Western is known to be one of the most prestigious schools in the country, but because I was still in hockey mode, and Western was one of the best hockey schools. As for what to study, I decided I want to get my kinesiology degree and then immediately go back to playing professional hockey once I graduated. Many players do use their scholarship packages, but when they do, they're already 4 years out of school and they're not prepared. Adjusting to student life, that was hard. I found myself sitting in my first university class at the age of 21, Introduction to Kinesiology. In a class of over 400 students, I was sitting in the back with a paper and a pencil, not even knowing how to take notes. I look up, I see about 400 MacBook, iPads and MacBooks with the lectures pulled up on their screen. I look back down and ask myself, what am I doing here? On top of that, playing at Western, let's just say, was completely different than what I was used to. The quality of the Canadian University hockey compared to what I was playing was a significant drop-off. Hockey was always priority number one, and now I'm on a team where hockey is second, if that. I couldn't deal with it. I became frustrated. I didn't enjoy going to the arena, practicing on terrible ice, and using equipment that wasn't even top of the line. Maybe I'd been spoiled, but the game was no longer fun. It felt like it wore me down. 20-hour bus rides, constant trades and packing up around North America, the superstitions, the mandatory workouts, the off-season training. It all became more stressful than the pure enjoyment and passion it once was. I can no longer focus only on hockey. There were no more elite personal trainers, NHL caliber coaches, country club gyms, chefs, massage therapists, signing autographs, many of the perks of playing a professional sport. Now I needed to balance varsity sports, academics, friends, social life, family, and my health, all while unknowingly dealing with post-concussion symptoms. In my third year of undergrad, I realized I didn't just want a kinesiology degree. I wanted to become a doctor. I had no idea what the requirements were or what GPA was required. It wasn't until I dialed in on medical school in my third year that I knew my hockey career was really over. This was a breaking point for me. I'd suffered my last concussion on the varsity team in a preseason game. I was going to hockey games directly from being in class all day, lectures from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m., and then be at the rink at 4 p.m. for a 7 p.m. game. How can I prepare properly for the game like this? Then I would get home at 10 p.m. and have to think about studying. How am I ever going to get into medical school like this? It was in that moment that I realized I couldn't balance everything, or anything for that matter, especially my post-concussion symptoms, and my mental health was deteriorating as a result. After suffering that last concussion, I went to class the very next day, and I couldn't even look at the screen or the projector. I called my mom crying after class, and I didn't know why. I said, I don't know what to do. I don't know what's happening to me. I know now. I was mentally unwell and emotionally unprepared for life after hockey. This was tough for me. My entire identity had been wrapped up in the game. One day you're signing autographs and the next day no one cares to know who you are. The dream of having a shot at fame and fortune disappeared. And like everyone else, I was faced with the trials and tribulations of growing up. The worst part was that it seemed like no one cared, but because to them, this is just a natural part of life. What I just described is the whole point of why I'm talking to you today. Hockey players are not equipped to deal with this transition. The lowest point in my life would also prove to be the pivot point. It gave me the chance to listen to that voice inside me, the one that always tells me the truth. The voice that used to say, one more rep, work harder, was now begging me to take better care of myself. The fighting, masking my pain with medications, drinking, eating garbage needed to stop. I needed to work towards developing my newfound identity. Some players don't end up finding that inner voice that leads them on the right path again. It's easy to resort to drugs and alcohol when you feel like you're at the bottom. This is why having the right support system is crucial. There are a lot of guys that go on to live great lives and have successful careers after hockey. It's not issues like employment, income, or starting a family that's difficult for them. It's the transition from hockey to real life, the in-between. It's being at the top of one profession and then the bottom of another. That is the battle and struggle that many of us face. I had no idea how to pull myself out of this spiraling dark time. But what I did know was that I needed to prove to myself and everyone else that I could be something other than an athlete or a retired hockey player who almost made it. Ironically, I chose the next hardest thing, a doctor. I didn't have anyone to turn to for advice and support, and which made me resent the sport that I dedicated my entire life to. I was left to figure everything out on my own. All I got out of it was a few letters of reference and I was sent on my way. Becoming a doctor is more complicated than becoming a professional hockey player. Half the battle of becoming a doctor is figuring out the requirements, learning exam strategies, applying to different medical schools and residencies. I was paving a new path, somewhat foreign to the hockey world. Until there is a dedicated program put in place to help athletes transition, I can offer you my advice that I recommend other ex-athletes do for a greater chance of success. First and foremost, seek support, any support. Surround yourself with a strong network of friends, family, and mentors from outside of hockey who can offer guidance and encouragement. When drafting this talk, I spoke with a few former teammates, and I must acknowledge that many other guys continue to play until their mid-30s. Many of them have families they need to support when they retire. Few players can swallow their pride and be satisfied with leaving the game at 21 to go to school or even have the chance. Reflect on your values and goals. Take the time to think about what is most important to you and what you want to achieve in your next phase of life. Stay active and healthy. There's no longer 3 months of off-season training to get in shape. It's almost maintenance training every day, all year. Exercise, eat well, and prioritize self-care and get good sleep. Explore new opportunities. Don't be afraid to try something new or take risks. You never know where a networking event, conversation, or a good deed might lead. These are very important to becoming successful. Don't wait. Athletes must prepare for life after hockey well before their careers are over. This could involve pursuing education, building a network of contacts outside the sport, and saving for the future. This is where the sports industry needs to do more to support athletes during and after their careers. The NHLPA and the PHPA need to continue prioritizing this for athletes who retire in their first year. This could include financial and mental health support to help athletes make the successful transition to life after sport. So, to all the athletes transitioning to life after sport, know that it is a normal and natural part of the journey. Embrace it as an opportunity to grow, learn, and explore new things about yourself. It will set you up for a successful and fulfilling post-athletic life. That's what I'm looking forward to do when I'm a practicing physician. I hope when an athlete comes to me for help or advice, I can be there for them and show them that there is life after hockey. I'm passionate about bridging the current gap between eager professionals willing to help athletes and the athletes themselves. My goal is to prevent athletes from going through the same struggles that I did so that their transition can be easier and to let any former, current, or future athletes know that you are never alone. Thank you.